Welcome back to part 2 of my IBM PC 5150 restoration. Now, you please don't ask me what happened to this keyboard. It really just looks borked.
The only question is, can I restore it?
Retro computing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. For dismantling the keyboard, I simply removed the two screws on the backside. As opposed to newer generation keyboards, where the cables are soldered onto, this one features a simple plug, so it would be easy to replace it as a whole. But it doesn't look too bad, except for the broken cable bushing. The keyboard legs are a total loss. One is missing altogether, whereas the other is shattered. There's also this huge breakaway, which I have no idea how it came to be. I start off by removing all keycaps. Beware for the spacebar. This one is fixed from the underside and cannot be removed. Don't even try, as you're going to destroy it. There is some kind of adhesive that is affixated onto the PCB. It's covered with some kind of foam, which has totally deteriorated over the years. To remove the backside, I could just bend away those locking retainers, but I think I can slide it out if I use two hammers. That seems to have worked very well. Now I can take the two apart. Now it's time to clean things up. There's lots of adhesive left to be removed. For the spacebar, I can now remove the retention needle from the backside. The spring bushings are just clipped into the upper side steel plate. By pushing them out, I eventually end up with holding this foam mat in my hands. It's terribly deteriorated and just gah! I remove all bushings to give them a good cleaning afterwards. For the steel plate, I will go down the route to sand it and have it repainted. I organized a new foam mat to put in place. Unfortunately, I didn't get one which covered the full width, so I have to piece it together. That's not really an issue though, as nobody will see this from the outside. Then I mark the center of all the bushing holes. I use a hole punch to make all holes for the bushings in the next step. Admitted, this is not 100% precise, but it's precise enough. The material is quite flexible and will align once I install the bushings. Don't forget to reinstall the spacebar first. Next is to put all springs back into place. The spring for the spacebar is a bit annoying, as it won't stick into place. I put some paper tape in place to keep it down for the backside cover installation. Ah! That didn't really work. I tore the paper tape apart. Let's try again using a cutout piece from an ESD bag. Darn, that didn't work either. I tore it apart as well. Next try, this time with a thicker layer for more stability. Alright, this time over worked removing it without tearing it up. Unfortunately, while I was just pressing front and backside together with a wrench, the retainers were still bent away, so I had to bend them back a bit. Anyway, it looks good so far, so I can put the keycaps back into place. The cover piece needs some love. There's definitely a lot of cleaning needed. For the big hole, I use some automotive plastics compound to reinforce it from the backside. For the front side, I use a 2-compound plastic superglue to fill it up. For the cork feed to be removed, I apply some heat with a heat gun. I will also try to bend back the steel plate into its original form. I must be gentle though, as I don't want the original paint to peel off. Then, after cleaning things up a bit, I re-glue the cork feed back into place. The keyboard originally featured a ground wire, though it was disconnected, hence I make a new one. Before I continue with the keyboard cable, I perform some checks if the wires are still connecting through. They are, that's great! Now I glue up the broken cable bushing so it will properly hold up. One bad thing about this glue will harden out. That means I need to enlarge the hole in the casing a little bit. Apart from that, I will also make a new ground loop connector that goes together with the ground wire that comes from the PCB. Speaking about cabling work, the spiral cable also needs some attention. I wrap it up on a coil, then heat it up so it will retain the spiral form. For the keyboard legs, I had my brother-in-law print me these replacements. Originally, they were all as well in this tan-like color, but with limited filament color options available, I chose black to be okay for me. This piece consisted actually of two printed elements with a centerpiece that I actually won't need. I remove it so I can properly insert the spring. I'm not sure if that was the case with the original feet, but I think it's a good idea to apply some grease to decrease the tension and physical stress on these moving parts. It's time to put the backside cover in place. But it doesn't work out in the first attempt. Remember what I had said about the glue applied to this cable bushing and how it would solidify. I had to remove already some material from the plastics enclosure, but it was obviously not enough. I had to run through it once again with the Dremel to remove some more material. But now, luckily, this second attempt paid out. I totally like how these 3D printed replacement feet fit in. It just works like a charm, and it totally feels like a keyboard again.
And this concludes at least part of my IBM Model F keyboard restoration. Unfortunately, I couldn't test it yet, as my IBM 5150 has a broken power supply. So, the ultimate truth, if the keyboard still works or not, is still to be revealed. Anyway, I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you did, then please give me a thumbs up. See you next time.